Welcome to Next Round with the Pacific Research Institute. I'm your host, Rowena Itchon. As our regular Next Round listeners know, at the end of every podcast, we try to offer a little cheer by asking our podcast guests for a wine, beer, or a cocktail recommendation. In this podcast, we offer a different kind of cheer. Meet New York-based comedy writer Sarah Rose Siskin. She's a lead writer for Star Talk with Neil deGrasse Tyson on National Geographic, as well as shows on Facebook Watch and Cartoon Media. She was also the lead writer for Mostly Weekly, a web series for Reason, and she's also written for Fox, CBS, and The New Yorker. She performs all over New York City and produces shows for Caveat Bar. Now, Tim and I, PRI's Director of Communications, are Chairman Clark Judge of the White House Writers Group, and I have all been former speechwriters, and we're all in agreement when we say that the hardest thing to do is to write a joke. Join us as Sarah gives us pointers on how to write a joke, discusses who's funny, what's not funny, is President Trump good for comedy, and the most important thing of all, how can we put more fun back into politics again? We were hanging on Sarah's every word. We think you'll enjoy this. Welcome to Next Round with PRI, Sarah.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
So we should tell our listeners first that Sarah was once a summer intern at PRI while she was getting her BA at Harvard. So tell us how your interests and career have evolved since graduating. How did you get interested in comedy?
I mean, I don't know what you mean. Isn't PRI a comedy feeder organization? Very clear path. I've been pretty much all over the map. I was studying politics in undergrad. Then I did my thesis on political comedy. When I graduated, I was hell-bent on becoming a naval intelligence officer. And then I decided maybe I'll do the second best thing. I'll get into comedy writing. So just, you know, the usual career path, really, that takes a detour through the military and then through Fox Business Network and then into comedy writing. I just started writing for a theater completely for free and happened to impress an executive at a comedy show and then got hired to write for a TV show, which I still write for now.
Joan Rivers, who is my all-time favorite comedian. I was lucky enough to see her twice in concert before she passed.
Oh, I'm jealous.
Yes. She famously refused to ever apologize for a joke over which she may have caught some heat. And in the documentary about her life, which is called A Piece of Work, and I highly recommend that our listeners watch it, she, I think, said it best when she was addressing a heckler who was offended by a joke she told, and she told the fellow, "Don't tell me what's funny. Comedy," she said, "is to make everybody laugh at everything and deal with things." Well, in this day and age of political correctness and all the wildness on our college campuses, it seems like someone can be triggered about just about anything that you say. Given that, can comedians really make people laugh without fear of pitchforks and mass protests coming after them?
Of course. I think there's a loose algorithm to comedy that most people don't appreciate, which is the amount of controversy a joke might inspire has to be proportional to how funny it is. You know, if you're going to make, if somebody's recently diagnosed with cancer and you're going to make a joke about it, it's got to be funny. You know, it can't just be pointing out the fact that something terrible has befallen somebody. If it's a really good joke, it will end up having that person feel better. It'll be a type of medicine. There's a type of comedy, it's called Juvenalian satire, which is the type of insult comedy we're used to. And that can be really, that can be good. It can be fun. It can be a way of humbling people, uniting people, leveling a field. But it has to be funny. At Harvard, I worked for a comedy organization called On Harvard Time. And we released a video where we made a joke about Yale. And there was a joke about how on a college tour, a girl asked about whether there were more like students in the walls, which was a dated reference to the fact that they found found bones in one of the walls of a room. And we got major flack for the implication that we were making fun of somebody who was apparently stuffed into a wall into a dorm many, many years ago. And from then on, our producers kind of implemented this rule, which was, how controversial is the joke? How funny do we find it? Is it worth it? And I always appreciated that because it was a way of saying, like, all right, well, this joke is pretty controversial, but it's not quite funny enough to pull it off. And we would talk about it in a sort of formulaic way, which was nice. But as for the Joan Rivers quote, I think I take issue with the fact that she says, don't tell me what's funny, because I am a firm believer that a laugh is never wrong. The audience is never wrong. And if a joke falls flat and the only person laughing is a comedian, I don't think the comedian is doing their job. Granted, you know, that might be a bad night, might be a bad audience. But for the most part, I think comedians, there's some abuse of rallying against political correctness where comedians will say, oh, well, my audience is just too sensitive, as a way to justify why their jokes didn't land. And so that, you know, it can be, political correctness can sort of be a pawn to be played either way, either to shut down a comedian for being too controversial, or for an unfunny comedian to say, like, oh, my jokes were actually really funny, everybody's just a snowflake. So unfortunately, political correctness is kind of like this unnecessary weapon in the world of comedy that can be used either way.
You mentioned insult comics. Back in the 1970s, that kind of brand of insult comedy with the Dean Martin roasts and Don Rickles, you know, that was all the rage. I mean, Don Rickles on Johnny Carson was appointment television every time he was on.
Yeah, and Letterman.
And Letterman, right. Now it seems like our tastes are changing, especially in this kind of PC world, and I guess she would be, or at least for me, the last best-known real insult comic today, Lisa Lampanelli, just announced that she's getting out of comedy altogether. So what are your thoughts on this trend? Has political correctness put an end to the art of the insult comic?
Absolutely not. It's a thriving industry. So long as there are people to insult, there are insult comics. I think, for example, Jeff Ross, the Roastmaster, is still alive and kicking. He just released a special on Netflix where it's pretty much just him and Dave Attell making fun of anything that will stand still long enough. So if this is assuring to you as a fan of Joan Rivers, don't worry, the insult comic art is not lost. One personal plug I want to make, I actually had a chance to meet Don Rickles. As a kid, I was on the Letterman show doing a bird call. It's a long story. I'll talk about it later. And Don Rickles saw me in the makeup room getting my hair done. He comes in. He says, what are you doing here? And I said, I'm doing a bird call. And he said, get a job, and then left. And I died of happiness.
Wow. I am so jealous hearing that story.
So I will say, like, I think you reach a certain level when you're an insult comic where when you insult somebody, it has the opposite effect where it feels like a badge of honor.
Now we can't let that go. How did you get into bird calls and how did you wind up in Letterman?
I don't understand this. It's so obvious. You know, you have your standard bird call, Harvard, think tank, and then comedy trajectory. It's just a very standard career path. I got into ornithology as a teenager, and there was a competition at my high school where if you won a bird calling competition, they would fly you out to New York and you would do it on the Letterman show so that he could make fun of you for 2 minutes and then go interview a real celebrity. And I managed to do a very pronounced northern gannet mating call. And that is how I got my career started in comedy.
That's amazing. Could you do it for us now?
I'm afraid that I require two other people to do it with me. Who are, one's in Berlin and I think one's in San Francisco. So our band needs to get back together in order to do the full call.
All right. Well, you know, let's turn to political comedy. For as long as we've had leaders, whether they're monarchs or politicians, societies have always felt compelled to make fun of them. In Shakespeare comedies, it's often the court jester who offers the most insightful comments. Talk about the role of political comedy, especially in our current highly polarized environment.
Sure. Yeah. So there's a Falstaff character who usually gets the king's ear, who's the one person who's able to talk to a person in power like a fellow person rather than a person in a powerful position. You know, as the stakes get higher, the importance of that kind of a role becomes higher. One of the things that makes comedy difficult in a polarized climate is you don't know what is common ground. Certain words get claimed by different sides and they're they're buzzwords that reveal your which team you're on, essentially. Like if I were to do a comedy set and stand up and say snowflakes, just the word snowflake, people would immediately assume that I'm sort of a alt-right Trump supporter type. If I were to get up and say white privilege, people would assume the other way. I have one joke in my set where I say between the alt-right and alternative fact, I feel like there's a, I can't really use the word alternative. I guess I'm going to have to find and then somebody in the crowd usually shouts out alternative at that point. But the point is, words get claimed very quickly, and it can make it difficult to just get your audience to listen. Because if you come out and people think that you're on the opposing team, they won't give you a shot. And if you come out thinking that an audience thinks that you're on their side, they'll give you a handicap, which is they'll laugh at your jokes just because they agree with you, which is a really frustrating thing. You guys might have heard of the term clapter. It's where you tell a joke that isn't funny, and so the audience claps instead of laughing. Comedians don't want that. It's a pity point. It doesn't really count. So it is harder in a highly polarized environment. I will say that. But I think that on the other hand, in a highly polarized environment, it raises the stakes and it makes it harder to come up with good jokes. But I think usually comedians rise to that level eventually. So right now with Trump, there's a big desperate grab to be the first to respond with the best, wittiest response. And sometimes, you know, audiences are left wanting. But I'm an optimistic person, and I think that comedians will rise to the level of the challenge. So yeah, that's my note of optimism.
So when I worked in the legislature, there was nothing more fun for me than writing jokes for politicians at the annual California Roast, which is Sacramento's equivalent of the big White House Correspondents' Dinner in D.C. Well, over the years, what was a supposedly off-the-record event in Sacramento found its way into the news media and into social media. So in this age of social media and cell phone cameras, it really seems like politicians are afraid of saying anything, especially telling jokes. So in your experience, how has the rise of social media changed comedy? Is everybody tweeting out jokes at a concert a good or a bad thing?
I don't know if this metaphor is going to make sense, but it reminds me of a story I heard of a really famous ventriloquist who tried to make it in radio. And like this is like at the beginning of radio. And after a little while, people were like, wait a second, we don't need the ventriloquist on radio. It doesn't make any sense. The reason why I make that metaphor is I think comedy is very much tied to the medium. And the problem with social media is that there's no tone. There's no performance. It's completely dry. People don't know how something is said. And we've evolved so that a lot of comedy, if not most of comedy, has to do with inflection and presence and performance. A lot of insult comic stuff completely loses its comedy when you're just reading it in a text or reading it as a tweet. So I definitely think that social media has played a big role. It actually reminds me of a really famous, fantastic Key and Peele sketch. They had this sketch show on Comedy Central, and the premise of the sketch was that one guy was texting another, and the second guy misinterprets one of the texts, so he thinks the first guy is mad at him. And they continue in this conversation for like 2 minutes, where the first guy is just making sarcastic jokes, but the second one across the town is interpreting these jokes as being very mean just by reading them out in a completely different intonation. And so finally they agree to meet up in a parking lot, and one shows up with guns and the other guy shows up with shopping bags getting ready to shop, and they realize they'd completely misinterpreted each other. So to me, like, that's emblematic of how we misinterpret often the gist of the comedy when people aren't aware that their messages could be misinterpreted. Now, all of that said, I think there's always a silver lining to this kind of stuff. There's a new art form of internet humor where people can capture emotion in writing. And a lot of that has to do with emoticons. A lot of that has to do with selective use of all cap or punctuation. I find it really, really fascinating. Like, for example, people talk about Trump's very, very distinctive form of writing tweet and like to parody that. The way that he says, you know, sad, or he uses exclamation points kind of willy-nilly and misspells words, that kind of stuff. Actually, it's weird because you can do an impression of somebody through their writing. Like, that's pretty original. That's pretty cool to do, like, impersonations of a president, but just through their writing. I don't know. There's something about that that seems exciting to me. So social media is a medium for good and for bad. It just depends on whether comedians can rise and adapt to the challenge. I have questions for you, though, about writing jokes for politicians. Did you do, like, any roasting kind of things of other politicians? And if so, what were some of your VIP jokes, if you remember?
My goal was always I wanted to win the roast, because there were other elected officials who would be up there telling jokes, and some were better than others. And we saw some really bad stuff, and you were embarrassed for them, people singing and bringing out bags of stuff because they thought props would be funny, and they weren't. The one that got the biggest laugh of all time, and it became the joke everybody referred to the rest of the evening. We had a female Speaker of the Assembly, Karen Bass, who's now a member of Congress. The roasters, it was three other women, and then my boss at the time, Mike Vallines, who was the Republican leader. His joke, he said, look at the lineup here tonight, and he rattled off the names of the other people on the stage, and he said, this looks like a reunion of the Golden Girls. That's a funny line, but everybody else the rest of the night referred back to that line.
I love that. When I worked for John Stossel at Fox Business Network, he would do these debates with Bill O'Reilly. And I was never really cut out for news because I was most excited about writing jokes for him. There were a lot of warning signs, Tim, that I should not have been in the news. But I would write these jokes for him as rebuttals, like evergreen rebuttals to O'Reilly if things started to go south. So if I told him, I said, John, if O'Reilly ever says something that is just too crazy for you to respond to, you should say, you know, I'd like to agree with you, Bill, but then we'd both be wrong. And while he found that funny, he would never do it on air. And it made me very disappointed. But I do love those kinds of one-liners, the sort of repartee. And I'm jealous that you got to write for the roast.
Well, you know, to add to that, Sarah, I had years ago, I was a research assistant at the White House. And I worked in the Ronald Reagan speechwriting office. And Ronald Reagan every year did the White House, I believe the White House Photographer's Dinner. And essentially what it was a slideshow of photos around the White House in Washington. And the president would have a couple of lines describing each slide. And before he gave the speech, I was going through the speech and I thought, oh my gosh, these are duds. They're boring. I don't know who's going to laugh. Who thought of these anyway?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
2 days later, when I saw the clips, I was laughing hysterically.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
You know, inflection, body language, and of course, if you have a master, an actor like Ronald Reagan, they were so genuinely funny. It was one of the funniest speeches he's ever given. And so yeah. I can understand your point there.
Well, one of the things that I always just love about Reagan's delivery is that he could really commit. Unlike other comedians or performers in any way, he could look very solemn. Like his most famous joke, the I promise I will not use my opponent's youth and inexperience against him. Like the way that he leads up to that joke, if you see him perform it, he is so serious that you are completely flabbergasted when he mentions his opponent's youth and inexperience. It's impressive because I will say from a comedian standpoint, it's a lot easier to signal to the audience, I'm about to make a joke, by giving that kind of inflection and looking mischievous. Because if you say something that doesn't make sense and people don't realize it's a joke, you'll just look insane. So you have to be very confident on a flipping presidential debate to say something so serious and just be that confident that it's going to land. Just like very, very impressive. Did you write that, Rowena?
Well, you know, we did. We actually had, oftentimes, we farmed it out to full-time joke writers for any kind of, you know, presidential speech where it required jokes. So, you know, the speech writers would try to write jokes, but as we all know, writing jokes is really one of the toughest things in the world. So we actually had expert joke writers do some of the president's jokes.
We had that, too, when I worked for Governor Schwarzenegger. We had John Max, who's a very famous comic. comedy writer, and if he would send us for every speech Arnold did, we would get a page full of jokes. And we loved it. We loved every day reading. We could only put in one or two in the speech. So that was always the highlight of our day when the batch of jokes would come in.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's one of the big magic tricks of comedy also, is that you, for every one joke you hear, there's about 10 or 20 that were written. In a way, it's, you know, it's the law of large numbers. You're going to get some. If you just throw your, the secret to comedy is if you just put yourself in a lot of pain and bang your head against a wall for many hours, you will come up with one good joke. That's the secret, kids. So go out and follow your dreams.
So, well, let's turn to our current president. The other day I watched an Intelligence Squared debate, and the debate topic was whether President Trump has been good for comedy. What do you think?
I think whoever proposed that debate, Rowena, must have truly been an intelligent and beautiful person in every way imaginable, just truly enlightened. And I might add, you know, even though it's completely unrelated, that I might have been the person to have pitched that debate to IQ Squared.
Really?
Yes, I know. It's hard to tell. But I pitched that, and I was so happy they went with it. So happy they cast it like they did with these amazing debaters. And then finally, so happy with the way that it turned out. It is a excellent source of strife between comedians about whether Trump has been good or bad. You will find that the only thing people share is enthusiasm that they are right in their position, and that people fall completely all over the spectrum when answering the question. It was interesting because at one point, PJ O'Rourke said, at any point, or any of us could argue the other side. And I even half jokingly suggested to the debate moderators that at halfway through the debate, they get up and they say switch, and everybody has to switch sides and argue the other side. But that was not taken, unfortunately. But it is true. Trump has been divisive, both very good and very bad for comedy. And I generally think that Trump has been good for comedy, and I'm in the minority of comedy writers for thinking that. The reason I think that is because Trump is superficially bad for comedy because he's so absurd that truth is funnier than fiction. It's hard to top what he actually says out of his mouth. But what that ends up happening is, since comedy is essentially upending expectation, now you've thrown into the mix a character who has thrown open the door of what you can expect. It means you have to come up with something truly unexpected for it to now pass muster with people's expectations. Trump has made people prepared for anything. Like, I could honestly tell a friend, oh, did you hear that Trump says we should bomb Tina Fey? And somebody would probably believe me. Because Trump is so crazy, we have, as comedy writers, you have to hold yourself to a higher standard of randomness and craziness in order for a punchline to land.
You know, Sarah, that's funny because I was seeing these promos of the debate, and that's how I thought of you. I thought, wouldn't it be fun to have Sarah on our podcast? And so I made the connection. So I think you were channeling me there.
Well, I would like to also make one extra plug for PJ. Both helped me out of a bind with this debate, but also I interviewed him for my thesis on political comedy, and he's one of the most articulate speaker of words there is in the world of political comedy. But he's very insightful on the sort of the mechanics of how to make a joke about politics. And one of the best parts of his opening argument during the debate was he spent about 5 minutes making self-effacing jokes about how he was a country club Republican and he was the only one in the room. And that is just perfect PJ, using politics and political comedy to actually unite a room. It's an incredible magic trick that he can announce, I'm on the other team. And at the end of the day, everybody likes him more. And I've always been impressed and somewhat mystified by how he does that. I mean, he does that constantly on Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me. And so he's long been a hero of mine.
As we discussed earlier, you know, writing jokes is not an easy thing. But from time to time, politicians or even regular folks may be called upon to get up and tell a few jokes when speaking in public. I have a book that somebody gave me once, and it's called Winning with One-Liners. And I don't recommend it at all because the jokes are neither winning or nor are they good one-liners. But I was hoping you could give our listeners some advice when non-professionals are called upon to write or tell a few jokes. And maybe you could share a little bit of what your process is for developing comedy.
Sure. I think you got to ask yourself a couple of questions. I mean, just going into this blind, the first thing is, who's your audience? Because I could pitch the world's most perfect joke, but if the person I'm telling it to doesn't get the reference, it falls flat. You know, if they don't speak the same language, you gotta change what you're saying. Hence, every single joke I've ever made to my parents where they didn't get the reference, it wasn't my fault. It was because they didn't get it. I definitely think you got to ask, who is your audience first? Sometimes when people write jokes, they're just writing to themselves, which is fine, because if you post that on Twitter, you'll find an audience like yourself. But if you're in a room, like, for example, PJ O'Rourke in a room full of liberals being a conservative, he knows that he has to be self-effacing in order to get them to laugh at later jokes. So the big thing is, who is your audience? Ask yourself that before you enter into the joke writing stage. Then the next thing is, what's the point? What kind of joke do you want to tell? Like, jokes sometimes do have an objective. For example, P.J. O'Rourke was using a self-effacing joke to get people to listen to his argument later. But sometimes you want to use a joke to unite people, to make them, to cheer somebody up. Maybe you want to just open up somebody. Maybe you're at a fundraiser and you want people to sort of loosen up. Maybe you're a warm-up comedian and you want to get people to also loosen up in a different way. So the other thing to ask yourself is, what's your objective? Then there's a bunch of different ways to go about writing a joke. There's a loose formula for jokes. So jokes, as I mentioned before, are like generally broadly defined, like upending expectation. So what you can do is establish a pattern and then break it. So, you know, you ask somebody, what did you do today? I read a book, I took a bath, and I ate a hamster. Like, it's one, two, banana. It's you have a set pattern and then you break it. And then you have to break it in a way that is delightful instead of tragic or random. And that's the hardest part. That's the magic part where, you know, at a certain point, things are just funny or not. And the only arbiter of that is a group of people in a room. But the formula is, you know, with a lot of variations, is establish a pattern and then break it. So I think, yeah, and the first test is you got to see if you find it funny. And then you do beta testing with your friends or with Twitter. And then you formalize it into a speech and you do a bunch of different iterations. I was lucky enough once to see Louis C.K. perform the exact same set two nights in a row. And I was lucky because I was astounded to see that he did the exact same set with the exact same intonation both nights in a row, but just tweaking the tiniest thing, the tiniest syllable, to like a scientist tweaking a machine to see if he got a bigger joke when he was shouting out a random number with some punchline. And on the first night, he said 1492. And the second night he said year three, and he was testing out to see what's a funnier random year. And he had kept everything the same except for that one tiny bit. And he does that hundreds of times. Now, most people don't have that kind of time and it isn't their full-time job, but you can definitely tweak jokes slightly to see if it's slightly more unexpected. So that's the formula of a joke. The other thing, watch comedy, imitate it. That's a huge thing. Imitation is the first form of comedy. Babies learn comedy when they start imitating you and you start imitating them. Mimicry is huge. And that's where a lot of the basis of impersonation comedy comes from. So that's a huge thing. So you also asked about my process for developing comedy, which it is never convenient when a joke comes to me. I'm not exactly doing heart surgery, but I'm usually in the middle of doing something else. And I'll have to be like, oh, excuse me, I've got a very important thing I have to write down. And then it'll just be something like, what if superheroes were fat? And it'll write down some terrible joke idea that later I'll try and mold into something funny. So I think the other thing is, yeah, my process is, at any point in time, I could not be listening to you. and thinking about a joke I'm working on.
So whose work do you admire? Who or what should we be watching or reading these days?
I would say Tina Fey. Her show Kimmy Schmidt has a really good episode about political correctness, where the premise of the episode is that a bunch of students are upset about what they consider to be a politically incorrect play. And it ends where one of the students offends herself and she says, "Oh my God, I've offended myself." And then she ascends to the heavens. And it's the best ending I've ever seen to an episode of anything. So Kimmy Schmidt is fantastic. In terms of political comedy, I think Veep is fantastic. It's cathartic to see other politicians yelling at each other and being just as vicious to each other as, you know, as they deserve. Saturday Night Live, I think, actually has pretty good self-parody of what it's like to live on like a liberal East Coast, and then also has a pretty good sense of uniting people. Not always, but some of the time. I'm always a huge fan. I would say in terms of reading, The Onion is always magnanimous, and their offshoot Clickhole are just, you know, paradigmatic sources of comedy for internet humor. They're just so current. What they do is an art. I'm always floored by them. And I read The Compost by Alexandra Petri in The Washington Post, which is a column, I think it's daily, a daily column by this incredibly talented comedy writer. And then, honestly, I would say whose work do I admire the most is, unfortunately, up until recently, Louis C.K., who I think is the greatest comedy writer and comedian I've ever seen. And I really hope that he pulls himself out of this and that he comes out with a stand-up set that addresses the Me Too movement and it addresses his allegations in a way that's healing. Because I think if anybody has any chance of having a moment of forgiveness and healing and processing, it would be Louis C.K. So that's my very dark horse optimism that maybe he will one day sort of lead to a moment of healing in this country. On a larger note, I actually think that political comedy is oversaturated and might be on the decline and leaning to a rise in science comedy. If you look at things like Rick and Morty, the cartoon, and Silicon Valley, and this other show called Star Talk with Neil deGrasse Tyson, airing Tuesdays at 7 p.m. on National Geographic. I actually forget the time we air. Anyway, there's a lot of science comedy shows that have taken the place of political comedy because I think political comedy sort of fractured itself into very niche pockets in a lot of ways. So I think we're seeing that people are turning their interests elsewhere in a lot of ways.
Now, who's got a better sense of humor, conservatives or liberals? What do you think?
Drunk people. I'd say it really depends on how much liquor they've had. But actually, I would say that sincerity is the death of comedy. So whoever is more ardent in their belief probably has the worst sense of humor. And comedy is blind. I've met extremely hilarious conservatives and liberals. It really just has to do with your temperament. I've met a lot of hilarious liberals who are to the left of Chairman Mao, but they have a good sense of humor and they can take a joke. And I've met conservatives who are just absolutely hilarious and they like, so it really, it's temperament based.
We always ask at the end of every Next Round podcast, our guests to share their recommendation for a favorite beer or wine or cocktail or even non-alcoholic beverage if you don't enjoy to imbibe. What's your favorite adult beverage to enjoy these days to get your creativity going?
Raging Bitch by the Flying Dog Brewery is fantastic, and it's very thematic because not only is it a delicious beer, it was actually sued. The owner of the brewing company was sued for obscenity because the beer's name was Raging Bitch. And they eventually won the suit, which was fantastic. And which is also fantastic because the beer's amazing. And so I like the story of the beer and I like the taste of it as well because victory tastes sweet. So Raging Bitch beer from Flying Dog Brewery.
Thanks, Sarah. Thanks again to Sarah Rose Siskin and to my colleague Tim Anaya. Follow Sarah on Twitter at SR Siskind. That's SRSISKIND. If you like this episode, please tell your friends and subscribe to PRI's podcast at iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, or TuneIn. And please do us a favor and give us 5 stars. You can also listen to our podcast on PRI's YouTube page, youtube.com/PacificResearch1. That's the number one. Thanks for listening. I'm Rowena Itchon. Hope you'll come back again for Next Round with PRI.